A blessed Sabbath day, church. Are you happy this morning? If you are happy this morning, you may say aloud, Amen. And if the purpose of your coming to this church this morning is you want to praise God because of His goodness that He has done to every one of us throughout the week, you may say, Praise the Lord. Yes, God is good. God is good. And all the time. I would like to invite the church this moment for the study of the Word of God. That the focus of our study can be found in the book of 2 Kings chapter 6 verses 1 to 7. If you have your Bible, I would like to invite every one of us to please join with me as I read these passages. I am reading from Good News Bible. It says here in verse 1, One day the group of prophets that Elisha was in charge of complained to him, The place where we live is too small. Give us permission to go to the Jordan and cut down some trees so that we can build a place to live. All right, Elisha replied. One of them urged him to go with him. He agreed, and they sat out together. When they arrived at the Jordan, they began to work. As one of them was cutting down a tree, suddenly his iron axe head fell in the water. What shall I do, sir? He exclaimed to Elisha. It was a borrowed axe. Where did it fall? Elisha asked. The man showed him the place, and Elisha cut off a stick, threw it in the water, and made the axe head float. Take it out, he ordered, and the man reached down and picked it up. Shall we pray? Father, we invite thy holy presence to our midst. We invite thy Holy Spirit to give us wisdom as we uncover the richness of your word that we have just read while ago. Thank you so much, Lord, that we are assured this very moment that you will speak to every one of us. In the blessed name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. According to the biblical survey, there were 123 miracles in the entire Bible. And out of those number, 37 of them were performed by Jesus himself during his earthly ministry. You know, while I am studying this topic, I come to realize that the God that we worship is a God of miracles. Amen? As we observe the passages that we have just read, as we look to the biblical passages, we will observe that the school of the prophets had grown to the point that they needed to provide new facilities. They were facing a problem that needs an immediate action. They were in unison of their cry to Elisha that the place where they are living was not enough for them to accommodate themselves because they were increasing in numbers. You know, church, with growth, we always experience growing pains, particularly the need for more space and resources to continue the growth of preaching, teaching, and building people in the Lord. Yes, growth is always exciting. Amen? This is a commodity in the ministry. You know, church, the school of the prophets is now experiencing the best problem that the church can ever experience. Brothers and sisters, the best problem or the best acceptable problem that we can entertain here in PIC is the challenge that because of our commitment, because of our participation in accomplishing God's mission that He has entrusted to our church, is our church one day is already small to accommodate the new believers or the new disciples. You know, I was in charge for evangelism. I had been here, church, because I was entrusted by the conference together with the university to work with you for evangelism. It was through this need and how the company of the prophets responded to the challenge that God responded miracles in their midst. Church, do you want to experience God's miracle in your lives? Do you want to experience it? Yes, I believe that every one of us wants to experience God's miracle. But maybe the question is, when do miracles happen? When do miracles happen? According to the light of this account, allow me to suggest four principles taken from these passages. First, miracles happen when we begin to understand the real problem. I would like to repeat. Miracles happen when we begin to understand the real problem. According to verse 1, one day the prophet said to Elisha, "The place where we met with you is too small for us." What was their problem? What was their problem? Their problem, brothers and sisters, the place where they gathered themselves was too small for them. You know, just recently, three of my churches in North Taguig District were voicing out to me and telling me, "Pastor, Pastor, what shall we do? Our churches are too small to accommodate our new members." You know, when I heard their cry, I told the elders of the church, I told the brethren of the church, "Praise God, hallelujah! This is the kind of problem that God desires most." You know, I told them, "You are just starting to experience the real problem." I would like to tell you, PIC Church, that our true problem that we need to experience, it's not about money. It's not about the misunderstanding of the brethren inside the church. It's not about the church leadership. But it's all about, brothers and sisters, if our church is not enough to accommodate our new members, because we are doing the task. We are doing the mission of the Lord. Amen. PIC, our problem here is that we don't have enough space to accommodate our worshipers. We are already about to experience God's countless miracles. That's the first principle. Miracles happen when we begin to understand the real problem. The second principle. Miracles happen when we begin to accept that we are part of the solution. Yes, there's a problem. There's a problem. We already identified the true problem, but that's not enough. We need to accept that we as members of this church are part for the solution. Let's continue the story or the account, particularly in verse 2. In verse 2, they were actually asking Elisha, "Why don't we build a new meeting place near the Jordan River? Each of us could get some wood, and then we can build it." Wow, what a suggestion. "That's a good idea," Elisha replied. "Get started." And everybody agreed to ask the necessary consent from Elisha to let him go. Take note, church. It was the brethren. It was the brethren who saw the need in the church. It was not the pastor. It was not Elisha. It was the ordinary members in the church who saw the need. Yes, a healthy church is a church that even ordinary members see and feel the needs. Aside from that, it is them who also initiated the necessary solution. A dynamic church is a church that everyone takes part to the solution of the problem instead of criticizing and finding faults of others. I remember the writings of Ellen White, dated in July 7, 1910. It says there, many today are fast asleep, as were the disciples. They are not watching and praying, lest they enter into temptation. Let us open, read, and give a careful study to those portions of God's word that have a special reference to these last days, pointing out the danger that will threaten God's people. We need keen, sanctified perception. This perception is not to be used in criticizing and condemning one another, but in discerning the signs of the times. I believe that we are all knowledgeable, especially we as a church that we are living in academic community. You know, one of my first, when I come to your church, the last time that I speak, it was 13 years ago. 13 years ago when I responded as a class pastor to the speaker. And I used to speak Tagalog. See, I used to speak Tagalog, especially I was assigned at Bulacan and Metro Manila and Makati and Taguig. It's very hard for me to adjust again, especially speaking English. That's why I believe we are all knowledgeable. I believe that maybe all of you are more than knowledgeable than me, maybe more than knowledgeable than us as pastoral staff in this church. I would like to tell you, use our wisdom, use our intellect, use our perception, use our education, not by any reason, not by criticizing, not by condemning, but I hope it is for the furtherance of God's work. Miracles happen when the church has a good relationship between leaders and members. Notice how Elisha responded. He said, "Go." It fostered a positive spirit, a mutual support to his students. That's why if we begin to agree that we are part of the solution to the problems that our church is facing, I would like to tell you we made ourselves channels of God's miracle. Second principle, miracles happen when we begin to accept that we are part to the solution. The third principle, miracles happen when we begin to act corporately for the solution. Let us take a look again, verse 2 to 4. How the company of the prophets responded. "So let us go to Jordan, and let everyone get to work cutting boards, and we will make a living place for ourselves there." And he said to them, "Go then." And verse 3, one said, "Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servant." And he answered, "I will go." So he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they got to work cutting down trees. You know, in King James Version, the word "go" was used 4 times in these verses alone. The word "go," I believe that the word "go" is very familiar to us. Amen? And in these verses alone, the word "go" was used 4 times. And it signifies that going is very important for us to experience God's miracle. And mind you, church, The word go was used as a corporate action and response to the need that they have. We are aware that the ultimate purpose of our existence, even we are in this academic world as a church, it is our main responsibility to carry out the mission and accomplish it. This mission is to make disciples. But we cannot do this unless we initially step forward, and that is the going aspect. This is the reason why going is very important, because we will not reach our target. We will not reach our target unless we are decided to go. You know, one of my previous churches decided to construct a new church building because of the necessity to accommodate the increasing new members. One Sabbath, I preached a sermon about self-sacrifice. I made an appeal to all members of the church to support our church project. And after the sermon, I went to the church office where the church treasurer and other members were counting the commitment of the brethren. When I was reading the pledges of the brethren written in a small papers, my heart was moved, saying what they have committed to God. Some of them wrote, "I am willing to give my 1 month salary for the church building." Some of them said, "I am more than willing to give my easy salary loan for the church." Some of them said, "I am more than willing to give my 1 month military pension for the church." Some of them said, "I will give 10,000. I will give 20,000. I will give 30,000. I will give 50,000 for the church building." Wow. I was impressed to the corporate sacrifice of the church. And before I left the church, the 8 million church building project was nearly finished, not because of the outside donations coming from other countries, coming from other brethren, but because of the corporate support of the brethren inside the church. We used to build a church. Amen. But we are always depending donation coming from other people, not maximizing our potential as member of the church. I told the brethren, God wants to perform miracles, not to any other people, but God wants to perform miracles primarily to us as church member of the church. Yes. Always remember that miracles happen when we begin to act corporately for the solution. Fourth principle, miracles happen when we begin to do extra sacrifice in achieving our calling. Miracles happen when we begin to do extra sacrifice in achieving our calling. Going back to the story, when everyone was excited to take part to the cutting of trees beside the Jordan River, here is a poor man who has nothing to use for the cutting of trees. But because of his strong desire to get involved in the ministry, he did not just stop and do nothing. Rather, he looked for ways to take part and borrowed an axe from his neighbor. It might be uncomfortable in his part to borrow something that might be very common or affordable to other households. Yet he composed himself so he can contribute to the mission work. You know, I always remember my student years, especially here at EUP. From elementary to college, because of poverty, that's why I was a working student when I came to this university, and I finished my course as a working student, working as swimming pool boy. And because of poverty, I could barely recall the times when I bought school supplies. Just like pencil, ball pen, papers, to be used for my classroom requirements. During quizzes and exams, I habitually ask papers from my classmates. I don't know of my teachers if they observed me during that time. Sometimes the quiz was already going on, and my classmates were very waiting for the question while I am left behind, not because I don't have anything to answer, but because I don't have the paper where I could put my answer. But still, because of my desire to pass the quizzes and the exams, I made myself skillful in making strong appeals to my classmate. Kinakapalan ko na lang ang mukha ko. Nakapalan ko na lang ang mukha ko. You know how annoying parasites are, right? It was a struggle, especially during my teenage year, asking always to my classmates. You know, asking once, asking twice, asking thrice from somebody may be acceptable or maybe tolerable. But if you are always asking it every day, you are always asking it all the time, and you are always asking it throughout the entire student life, oh, it's already a different thing. What a tragedy. Have mercy on me. Yes, it requires a very big courage to survive. It's humiliating, but making my face callous was my only option. It's my only option. That's why I make this appeal to our full-time students. I make this appeal to our full-time students. If your classmate keep asking from you, especially those who are working students, don't be tired doing good to your classmate. Because you might be doing a lasting ministry to your classmate. And I am one of the products of those students who extended their extra resources to me. So I praise the Lord for those generous students. Because if not them, I don't know where to go. Especially during quizzes and exams. No. Yes. According to Apostle Paul in the book of Galatians, chapter 6, verse 9, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season you will reap the harvest if you will not give up. Church, today, it may not be hard to acquire an axe, but to the poor man like him, it takes extra effort or sacrifice to provide himself so that he can participate to that noble cause. Church, When we say sacrifice, maybe all of us, especially those who are working in this university, maybe you are always doing sacrifice for the Lord every day. But allow me to tell you, speaking to sacrifice, it's beyond our ordinary job. It's beyond our daily responsibilities. It's beyond to our 8 hours requirements. It's beyond to our regular tithes and offerings. It's beyond to our classroom responsibilities. It's beyond to our academic responsibility in this university. It's beyond to what is normal, and that is the sacrifice. If we learn to do extra sacrifice, we begin experiencing God's miracles in our lives. When we begin to understand the real problem, when we begin to take part to the solution, when we begin to act corporately for the solution and make extra sacrifice, mind you, church, it is not hard to experience God's miracle in our lives. It is not hard for God to perform miracles to this church and even to our university. Amen. And God is so excited to perform miracles to every one of us. God is so excited. He's just waiting for us. How we will respond to His invitation. Let's continue the reading in verse 6 and 7. Where did it fall? According to the poor man. Where did it fall? Elisha asked. The man showed him the place, and Elisha cut off a stick, threw it in the water, and made an axe head float. Take it out, he ordered. And the man reached down and picked it up. You know, based on the light of these passages, the primary miracles that God wants us to experience are, first, allow me to give three miracles that God performed to this poor man. First, was the miracle, next slide. First miracle was the miracle of confession. After borrowing the axe, here was the poor prophet who was excited to cut trees, and out of that excitement, he may have given his full strength every time he struck the tree. But unfortunately, when he was cutting the tree, the axe head was detached from the handle and fell into the water. His immediate reaction was crying out, "Oh, no, master, that was just a borrowed axe." He was so worried for two reasons. First, he can no longer participate in cutting the trees, of course. The second, what worried him most was the fact that it was just a borrowed axe, and for him, there's no way to recover it again. You know, his reaction not only shows his deep concern, but it demonstrates his integrity. When this man realized the axe was gone, he immediately told Elisha what had happened. And you know, telling Elisha what had happened was a sign of his confession about his great need to recover the lost axe head. And confession is very important for us to regain our lost power, to regain our lost identity, to regain our lost condition. But you might ask me, Pastor, when to confess? You know, I would like to tell you, as soon as we feel the emptiness in our lives, we need to do immediately. We need to confess immediately. Don't wait for tomorrow. Don't wait for another week. Don't wait for another years. Do it while the Spirit of the Lord is on fire in your lives. Confess our sins to Him. He confessed the fact that he had lost the cutting edge. And at the moment, brothers and sisters, at the moment we commit mistakes, always remember that the Lord desires to perform miracles in our lives, and that is the miracle of confession. You know why confession is a miracle? You know why? Because confession is a miracle because we cannot do it by our own. We are vulnerable, we are weak. We can only do it by God's grace, by the power of His Holy Spirit, who is always working in our conscience. That's why it's a miracle. Yes, the first miracle that performed by God to this man was the miracle of confession. The second miracle was the miracle of coming back. The real miracle of coming back. As soon as Elisha heard about the problem, he called the prophet to go back to the place where the axe head was lost. To recover it, they need to go back to that place where it was lost, of course. The same is true with our spiritual arena. Before we can recover the power of God in our lives and in our church, we must return to that place where we lost the power. That is, we must uncover the reason why the power has been forfeited in our lives. We need to understand and realize the factors and reason why we lost our cutting edge. Is it because of some sins that we had committed? Is it because our priorities have become misdirected? Or is it because we are guilty of trusting the arm of the flesh instead of trusting to the power of the Holy Spirit? Church, where did we lose the power? The miracle of coming back will happen to our lives after confessing our sins and our nothingness to God. Yes, it will happen if we will listen and obey God's voice. And notice the instruction of Elisha. After hearing the cry, his question, where did it fall? It was like saying to this man, return to the place where you lost your axe head. Brothers and sisters, if you want to recover your axe head, you need to come back and return to the place where you lost it. And by doing so, you will experience the miracle of restoration. That was the miracle of coming back. The third and the last miracle that I would like to share to you this morning was the miracle of commitment. The miracle of commitment. The last thing this young man did was to reach down and take the axe head in his hand. This may be the end of the story as far as the biblical record is concerned. But we can be sure what happened next. This young man firmly reattached the axe head to the handle and went back to work chopping down trees. He had recovered the cutting edge and was able to do what is needed to be done. This is the miracle of commitment. At the moment that you extend your hands and receive the cutting edge, you will experience again the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We just only recommit our lives to Him. Church, God's power is always available for those who are willing to pay the price and who are willing to reach out and take it by faith. When we come to the place where we lost our cutting edge and are willing to handle our loss, the cutting edge in our loss of the cutting edge in God's method, He will give us back the power to do His work. However, it is not for the faint-hearted, it is for the faithful-hearted alone. Church, we are now recognizing, if we are now recognizing our limitation, and we are saying to God, Lord, we are nothing at all. We are nothing at all. We are experiencing the miracle of confession. Church, if we are now coming to the place where we lost God's power in our lives, we are now experiencing the miracle of coming back or the miracle of restoration. Church, if we are now surrendering our lives to God and we are putting everything to His hand, and be willing to be restored His power into our lives, we are now experiencing the miracle of commitment. How committed are we? How committed are we? How committed are we to the idea of experiencing God's miracle or God's manifest power here in our church? Yes, our level of commitment will be revealed by what we are willing to do to see it become a reality. You know, according to the writings of Ellen White, in the evangelism book, the book of evangelism, page 65. Next slide, please. According to her, the conversion of the human soul is of no little consequence. I would like to mark this statement. The conversion of the human soul is of no little consequence. It is the greatest miracle of divine power. Wow. Do you want to experience that miracle? Do you want to participate in performing God's miracle in the lives of other people? Especially those people who are still in darkness. Are you willing to participate, to experience God's miracle by extending our ministry, by extending effort to our non-day students here in this university, whatever your profession is. This question, would like to leave this question to the church. No, God wants us to be His agent in showing His manifest power through the conversion of the human soul, but we cannot do it without the cutting edge. We cannot do it without the cutting edge. In conclusion, remember the cutting edge was restored when Elisha cut a stake and threw it into the water. From it, the miracle of restoration happened. Church, the greatest miracle that God performed through the ages is when Jesus hangs on the tree. The tree where Jesus was crucified through the cross of Calvary. Do we want to experience the miracle of His death and the miracle of His resurrection? Well, church, we need to confess our sins to the man who was hung on the tree. Do we want to experience God's miracle? We need to come back to the place and realize where did we lost our access or God's power. Do we want to experience God's miracle? We need to recommit again our lives to Him by reaching Him in faith. You know, church, God provided everything through His Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross in order for us to be totally restored again unto Him. Church, do you want to experience the miracle of restoration? The miracle of confession? The miracle of commitment? Well, let's come and surrender our lives to the one who died on the cross. To the one who died on the cross. And share the power of His life. Share the power of His death. Share the power of His resurrection. And share the power of the good news that He is coming back again. Come with me, church. Let us experience together God's miracle that He's about to perform in this church, that He's about to perform to every one of us by involving ourselves and by participating in finishing the mission of the church, the mission that He has entrusted to every one of us, the mission that He has entrusted to our church today. Church, before I sit down, I would like to ask you, do you want to experience God's miracle in your lives? Can you say aloud, amen? God bless you, church.